If your grandma overhears you talking with your friends and using words like skibbity and hey chat, she probably has no idea what you're talking about. It's not her fault. You might speak differently when you're around different people or in different contexts. That's the general idea of code switching, which might seem fairly harmless, but research suggests that it can impact everything from childhood learning to medical safety. Here's what happens when your code switching software is running 24/7. When you're speaking with your grandma versus your friends, you might use different speaking styles or entirely separate vocabularies. And code switching is how you swap between those vocabularies depending on who you're talking to or where you are. If you're bilingual, weaving between languages can be a really clear example of code switching. Maybe you've said something in Spanish to your abuela on the way out the door, and in the same breath started talking in English with some friends. Research published in the journal Bilingualism, Language and Cognition shows that bilingual children regularly code switch. In fact, code switching is pretty common for anyone who's bilingual. And it's not just language that can swap out. Accents, word choice, and body language can all be part of code switching. But even if a lot of people do it and make it look easy, it can still use a lot of mental energy. This was studied in 174 children who are bilingual in Spanish and English. The study focused on how three factors interact with each other. One, how often the kids were exposed to code switching. Their parents reported how often family members code switched in front of the child on a scale from 1 to 10. 2, how good the kids are in each language. The children took Spanish and English language tests that assessed how well they spoke and understood each language. And 3, how much mental space are they working with? This final test determined the kids' verbal working memory. If your brain's a stovetop, then verbal working memory is like how many burners you have available. When you let these kids cook, they do as they're told and repeat back longer and longer sequences of numbers, but in reverse. Remembering and manipulating all that info is the kind of thing you definitely need plenty of burners for. Results showed that for kids with low verbal working memory, code switching was actually detrimental to language acquisition. Generally, kids who maxed out earlier in stovetop space scored lower on the language test when the adults around them code switched more. So if you don't meet a certain threshold, then even using all your burners, it can be harder to understand conversations that involve code switching. But for students with higher verbal working memory and plenty of burners to go around, higher exposure to code switching was correlated with higher language skills. So if you do have that space, you're ready to learn two languages simultaneously. So code switching can have very different effects on your language development, person to person. But your own verbal working memory isn't the only factor that determines how well you learn when adults code switch around you. The way adults code switch also plays a role. A 2019 study investigated how teacher code switching affected students' cognitive flexibility. In this study, cognitive flexibility was measured by how well the students could sort stuff. For each trial, they needed to focus on either the shape or color of whatever's in front of them while ignoring the other. And then partway through, they'd focus on the opposite quality. As the students performed this task, their teachers were also being assessed. Researchers recorded how frequently the teachers code switched, and if they did it in the middle of a sentence, or from one sentence to the next. It turned out that when teachers switched between English and Mandarin in the middle of a sentence, their students were more likely to do better in the sorting task. And this wasn't true if the teacher spoke one sentence in English and the next in Mandarin. So code switching in front of children can be a good thing. And once you learn to code switch, you have access to two ways of communicating, which can help when you can't seem to find the right word in one language. That can be especially helpful when you're just learning language as a child, or when things like dementia make it harder to recall words as you age. But consequences can pop up when it becomes a necessity to code switch into the majority language or dialect. That first study I mentioned found that children proficient in code switching between English and Spanish, or English and French, found themselves switching into English more often than into the other language. Such an early and consistent preference for one language can eventually mean losing the other altogether. And growing up bilingual is just one scenario where code switching can become a necessary part of your daily life. Adults in minority groups face a lot of pressure to code switch to avoid racial discrimination. In the US, African American folks find themselves code switching so much that Black or African American vernacular English has been distinguished from so-called standard English. In a study published in 2001, 1971, researchers asked 97 African-American students to review recordings that were spoken in Standard English, African-American Vernacular English, or a mixture. Participants rated the Standard English recordings as smarter, more aesthetic, and people that the participants would want to get to know better, more than the African-American Vernacular English recordings. And a 2021 study, also in the US, found that both Black and white participants perceived Black people who code-switched as more professional than those who didn't. All of that contributes to what's called impression management, where people in minority groups will code-switch to improve how they're perceived. And many academic or professional spaces are set up so that you might only be able to be successful if you conform to the dominating culture. So the pressures to code-switch come from all sides, and all of those pressures take a toll. Many studies have suggested that code-switching is incredibly tiring.
Oh,
it so is. Especially if you don't do it that often. In those cases, the brain power needed to code-switch is literally detectable by EEG, an electrode cap that measures the electricity in your brain. Beyond that extra work, you might feel disingenuous. Not being able to be your authentic self sucks and can negatively impact your own cultural identity when you have to conform too much. And in medicine, inauthenticity can have bigger effects, like poorer health outcomes for patients and increased burnout in physicians. Studies have found that patients are more likely to trust physicians that they view as authentic, and that trust, or lack of trust, is a determinant of vaccine hesitancy. You know, vaccines, the things that keep you healthy and are undisputed by the global medical and science community. A review of multiple studies also found that trust between you and your doctor leads to you actually listening to their guidance and ultimately having better health outcomes if you're managing conditions like diabetes, cancer, or HIV. So when society is pressuring physicians to code switch, like it's pretty much pressuring everyone to do, then we all suffer. Researchers in California gave Chinese American parents and their children an intentionally frustrating puzzle toy, and they observed that frustration increased how much parents code-switched back to their primary language. And if you're in a society like the US that equates speaking white with values like professionalism and intelligence, then you might feel like you need to suppress your emotions to prevent those involuntary code switches. Oh yeah, maybe like definitely. So peer-reviewed research suggests that code-switching can use up more mental energy, shake your personal identity, influence your career, and impair healthcare outcomes. But studies also demonstrate how code-switching can benefit you, like when you first learn language and when it starts to slip away in old age. By welcoming diverse voices and making changes like designing voice assistant devices to respond to African-American vernacular English just as well as it does to standard English, we can tip the scales towards the positives. And that is a switch worth making.